across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wauwatosa studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Brightlow.
And he's getting set to give you Brewers tickets. 4 tickets to Saturday's game against the St. Louis Cardinals at American Family Field. Coming up in less than 15 minutes, you're going to need to text to win. You can do that through the Civic Media app. So you got a good 10 plus minutes to get the app downloaded, get set to text one of the stations where you hear Up North News Radio, and be set to win Brewers tickets. On the national day calendar today, it's Children's Mental Health Awareness Day. It is it's Lost Sock Memorial Day. It is a day for the buttons, a day to celebrate buttons. It's Tear the Tags Off the Mattress Day, and it is Moscato Day, which clearly the Moscato is the reason why we have 3 other really unnecessarily goofy things on the calendar for today.
Excuse me, Jay and I will be talking about Lost Sock Day with a guest, so just respect, all right? Respect.
Are you serious?
I'm dead serious.
Are you serious? You have a guest for Lost Sock Memorial Day?
We are going to be interviewing the owners of Wigwam Socks. They are a sock company here in Wisconsin, and they've been here for a very long time, and they're going to be our guest on National Lost Sock Day.
So, I have loved Jane Matinair for decades on Milwaukee radio, and I'm so glad she is on our team now. She's, you guys from 10 to noon are epic.
Yeah,
and
we are.
Sock Memorial Day,
and it's Moscato Day, and what better way to celebrate than with some Merlot?
Oh, I see what you did there. Brittany Merlot is here to give us the forecast. Right after we tell her that, before we leave the calendar, Roger writes in to say that on this day in 1992, the Golden Girls aired their series finale.
Oh.
That doesn't seem right. 32 years now? Ooh. And yesterday, it had been 40 years to the day from the series finale of Happy Days, which was fine because it had jumped the shark, quite literally. They started the phrase because of Happy Days. But Golden Girls, isn't it weird to see us approach... some of you are just only approaching the ages. Some of us are already at the ages where these actors and actresses were on the Golden Girls at the time and going, oop, when did that happen?
And then they had a very short-lived spinoff called The Golden Palace featuring a very young Don Cheadle.
I never know when he's kidding or not.
I'm not. What do I gain from that lie?
Seriously, it's like the sock thing. I'm like, you have a guest for the sock? You are so good at this. You could... Bluff your way into anything involving me, Greg Buck. You are so good. From Tigerton, it's partly cloudy and 48. Rob says yesterday was a beautiful day. Got his mowing jobs done in the Wittenberg area. Lunch with his school teacher and football coach. And says he remembers Tommy Rowe and Sweet Pea. He had that song in his playlist as well as Billy Joel's Piano Man. And now we turn things over to Ms. Merlot to tell us about what kind of a day we have in store as we start to wrap up the work week and speed into the Mother's Day weekend, Brittany?
Yeah, so we've got some rain in the southern parts of the state ongoing right now. About a quarter of an inch to a half an inch is likely with this band. And of course, we're going to see some isolated spotty showers throughout the afternoon, especially south. Some of those sprinkles could sneak their way into parts of central Wisconsin, but we're definitely seeing cooler temperatures, breezier winds. They're gusting out of the north right now up to 15 to 20 miles per hour. And that's going to keep our highs today down south in the upper 50s. And it's actually going to be warmer into the northern parts of the state where we're going to see some low to mid 60s today. Because if you're up north, you're going to see a little bit more sunshine. So if you didn't notice, Roger's last name is Frost. Awesome. I wanted to point that out earlier. And we also have a frost and a freeze watch for parts of northwest Wisconsin overnight tonight, because temperatures are going to be dropping to about 30 to 35 degrees in northern Wisconsin. So growers, gardeners, you're going to need to protect those plants as those temperatures still are crashing cold through the next week here.
But that's it. This is the last one. I mean, you can't say that. I'm going to say it. I'm done with this. I'm done with the frost. I'm done with lows in the 30s. Let's get on with spring already. And looking ahead for folks that are trying to plan for their Mother's Day, you know, weekend plans. Again, it's Thursday, but what's your intuition tell you about how the outdoor plans would be looking for Mother's Day on Sunday?
Honestly, Sunday's looking like the best day of the weekend. Yes. We do have a system pushing through Saturday, so let's get that out of the way. Sunday, temperatures actually get a little touch warmer. We'll see some sunshine out there. I think Mother's Day is going to be quite pleasant for those wonderful moms out there. Oh,
such a good Mother's Day present from you.
I'm trying. I definitely don't want severe storms on Mother's Day, that's for sure.
No, absolutely not. And the Brewers will be playing at home, and they always seem to have these epic wins on a lot of Mother's Days. So maybe they could make that happen again, too.
That would be fantastic. And on the sock debate or whatever we're talking about with these socks, I'll never forget a couple years ago, I had a guy rush to the TV station to tell me how to prevent lost socks. He brought me a bunch of little paper clips, right? Little clips, little pins. He's like, just put them together and you'll never have this problem again.
Does he understand centrifugal force?
I have questions.
I do too. It shocked me.
I want to see the weather lady, so I'm going to bring her paper clips for her socks.
It was crazy. I don't know how we got in, but he did.
Oh, God. Oh,
that's not even a little bit troubling, is it? No. All right. So you didn't actually try the clips?
No, I didn't. But, you know, okay. If anyone out there has, let us know.
Okay.
Let us know how much your bill was when they had to fix your dryer.
Yes. I still have such a charge over Greg and Jane getting a sock guest for today. These are amazing. Thank you, Brittany, so much. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Have a good day.
All right. Hey, a reminder, you can get the Up North News daily newsletter every day delivered to you by heading to our website. That website is upnorthnewswi.com. Again, don't forget the WI, upnorthnewswi.com, where you can see all the news stories that we're working on. And you can also sign up for our newsletter there, upnorthnewswi.com. I mentioned that we're going to be giving away Brewers tickets. We're going to be doing that in about 7-8 minutes or so. And again, you will want to have that Civic Media app in order to text us. We are on 7 radio stations around Wisconsin, including WAUK in Waukesha, locally grown radio WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids, Bull Falls Radio in Wausau, 93.5 The Tap in Chippewa Falls, The Eagle in La Crosse, Lake Air in Amory, and Buzz of the North in Hayward. And that way, if you're on the app to listen to us, you just pick any one of those stations and listen live and you'll hear this program. Pick one of the other stations and you'll hear one of the other talk shows or music programs that are on there. But again, use that app in a few minutes and maybe you can win 4 tickets to Saturday's game against the St. Louis Cardinals. We were speaking in our last hour a bit about President Biden coming to Racine, and Vice President Kamala Harris will be making a trip back to Wisconsin before too much longer as well. Again, just underscoring the battleground nature of the state and the need to have essentially a record to run on, which is what, you know, President Biden was pointing to yesterday in the area of job development and manufacturing development, high-tech, high-end manufacturing development in the state. I couldn't help but notice that he took a shot at one of his favorite targets. That, of course, would be Wisconsin Senator Ron Johnson. And I don't have the audio clip with me here, but Biden could not help but take a shot at Johnson and Trump about the Foxconn venture that didn't venture very far, but he did note the $10 billion promise that had been made that never materialized by Foxconn. Biden's quote was, you know, they came here with your Senator Ron Johnson literally holding a golden shovel, promising to build the 8th wonder of the world. And look what happened. They dug a hole with those golden shovels, and then they fell into it. He noted that about 100 homes were destroyed to make way for the project, which wasted hundreds of millions of dollars, Biden said, saying Foxconn turned out to be just that, a con, go figure. To which I would say, again, to be fair, there are jobs there. There is work being done there, just not nearly as much as had been promised by Trump, who, by the way, today will be back in court because the court where his hush money trial is being held will be back in session. They are off on Wednesdays, but not only will Donald Trump be in there, Stormy Daniels will be back on the stand testifying as well. Well, actually, her testimony is over. She's now under cross-examination by Trump's attorneys after she recounted in sometimes graphic detail, you know, their alleged 2006 sexual encounter where the president paid her through an attorney to keep quiet in the waning days of the 2016 presidential election. Trump's attorneys are seeking to poke holes in Stormy Daniels' credibility, trying to accuse her of being an extortionist, and rehearsing her testimony, which I thought was particularly funny because I think most lawyers would know that, and I know hope most jurors would as well. Yeah, you do rehearse your testimony. You go over those points with your lawyer over and over and over again to make sure that you're telling, you know, your side of the story as consistently as possible. I think in Trump's case, they're just used to a guy who makes up everything on the fly, and you never know what's going to come out of his mouth the next. And it does lead people to wonder, will Trump testify in this case and deny that there was any kind of sexual liaison, deny that he ultimately wanted business records falsified in paying hush money to Stormy Daniels? But what has happened in so many cases is that Trump says he's going to testify and then he never does. He has definitely testified in depositions. We've seen those where he's either taken the Fifth Amendment or he's, you know, given conflicting information. But once Stormy Daniels is done, there may only be one or two more witnesses brought up for the prosecution, maybe former Trump attorney Michael Cohen, who had arranged that $130,000 payment and later went to prison for orchestrating it in a fraudulent manner. So we'll look for that testimony today, the cross-examination today. And as far as the other trials go, it looks like all of them are postponed or put off for indefinite reasons. This may be the only trial voters will be seeing between now and November in deciding whether one of the candidates for president turns out to be a convicted felon. In sports at 7:18, Kansas City took 2 out of 3 from the Milwaukee Brewers. They won yesterday 6-4, the Royals did. Gary Sanchez hit his 5th home run of the season. Christian Yelich went 0-for-5 in his first game back from a low back strain. They're now home for a 7-game homestand, starting tonight with the first of 4 against the St. Louis Cardinals this weekend. And we have got 4 tickets to Saturday's game coming up in just about 90 seconds or so. We will have you text to win, so get that Civic Media app ready. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this Thursday morning, when you're here, you're up north. We'll be right back. So much that we're playing from Billy Joel on his 75th birthday. Even though I'm in love, one of the main reasons I love Leave a Tender Moment Alone is less about Billy Joel and more about his choice for who was playing the harmonica at the top of that song, and then has a beautiful harmonica solo in the middle there. The late Toots Thielemans. And again, I didn't know the name at first for the longest time, and I finally was wondering who is playing this harmonica so well. And you've heard it before. He's the guy that played the harmonica on the Sesame Street theme. So especially in the closing theme of Sesame Street, you were hearing Toots Thielemans. You also hear him in Julian Lennon's single Much Too Late for Goodbye. And he's only performed it once live with Billy Joel, and it's definitely worth it to look that up on YouTube as well. All right, let's give away some Brewers tickets. There are 4 of them available for Saturday's game against the St. Louis Cardinals, and we're looking for, I'm going to ask you a question, and we're going to look for the first person who will text in the correct answer. So first I'll tell you, from a rules standpoint, send us a text to win these tickets if you can use them, because they're really good seats. I've been in these seats, and they're great, and we don't want the tickets to go to waste. If you're texting through the Civic Media app, you just have to go to the app and go to one of the stations where you hear Up North News Radio, and we listed those just a few minutes ago, and then hit the text button on there and send us a text, and here's what you're texting. To sign up for the Up North News daily newsletter, what website do I always tell you to go to? What website do you go to sign up for the Up North News daily newsletter? Text me that .com address first, and you're going to get 4 tickets to Saturday's game at St. Louis. Now, if you're the first one through, we only see phone numbers on there when people text in. So feel free to, you know, add your name if you want to. But if you're in a hurry, you just want to text the correct web address to me, we'll text you back and we'll get your name and we have to get your email address, because that's how we deliver the tickets, is through email. So again, what's the website you use to sign up for the Up North News daily newsletter? Be the first person to text that through the Civic Media app to us, and then we will be more than happy to set you up with 4 tickets for Saturday's game. And then we'll do something similar tomorrow, 4 tickets for Sunday's game. So again, use that app and send us your text. Coming up in a few minutes, we're going to have our Women Win Wisconsin segment. State Representative Robyn Vining is going to be the guest for Kate Duffy and Danielle Lynn Scampini. And they will talk all about the importance of getting involved. There's so much that is said about how especially women, especially suburban women, have been making a difference in recent elections, in some recent elections. And it's not just about what they're thinking and saying, but what they're doing. And again, that's only one group of key voters. There's also been a lot said about communities of color, especially Black women, and the roles that they are playing in elections. And of course, there's that whole rural swath of Wisconsin that has been very Republican-leaning for a very long time, but not that long. It wasn't that long ago that you had an entire northern half of Wisconsin that sent Dave Obie to Congress for 40 years and also sent a good number of Democrats to the state legislature. That pendulum has swung the other way for a time. But again, as people have seen what's happening in the Republican Party, the extremism that's involved, and the downright hostility to democracy, it's meant that much more for progressives and Democrats in some of these rural counties to get more organized, get more involved, and to speak out. So when you visit with our friends at Motherhood for Good as part of our Women Win Wisconsin segment, keep in mind that while they may be talking about, you know, the suburbs of Milwaukee, Madison, the Twin Cities in West Central Wisconsin, it really does apply to any of us who can step up our civic engagement and get a little bit more involved in these elections, and then, you know, consider voting, consider becoming a donor, consider becoming a candidate as well. All of these things are possible, but only if we can continue to persuade you to get more involved, to be more than just a passive listener. In fact, if this were, I know we're on video, on live video on several social media sites, but if this were strictly a TV program, I'd put up this graph up on the screen that I made some time ago when I was telling people. They were saying, well, you know, what is Up North News, and what do you do, and who's your target audience? And there are actually multiple target audiences. And let me describe them quick, because I want you to think of where you are in this and whether you can move to a different place in this chart, okay? So close your eyes, not if you're driving, sorry. And in your imagination, all right, we're going to do an x-axis and a y-axis. And of course, the x-axis is left to right, you know, with the political left and the political right and the political center. Okay, that's easy enough. Now the y-axis. Up at the top, 100%. You vote in every election, every election. The spring primary in February, you vote in that one. And then, of course, you know, dead set in the middle is you vote about half the time. And then you drop way down, and you've got people who never, ever vote. All right? So in the far upper left is basically the Democratic base. You know, the people to the far left, and they vote every time. And that is not one of our target audiences at Up North News. It's like, okay, you already know how you're thinking about things, how you're feeling about things. And the same can be said for the far upper right. I mean, that's now the box marked MAGA. You vote every time. You can't wait to vote for Donald Trump and others like him. Again, not really anybody's target audience, because you are where you are. When you hear all about swing voters, Those are the people up high on the chart and in the center. They vote every time, but they are honestly open to voting for a Republican or a Democrat in every given race. There's actually not a lot of those, if you want to be honest. There's a lot of people who are a little more to the left or a little more to the right. They're willing to cross the line, but they tend to vote one way or another. Obviously, that is like the ultimate swing voter category, and so many people beam their messages to them. But where Up North News and Courier Newsroom come in, and I can't speak for Civic Media, not being a Civic Media employee, but I would say probably a good part of Civic Media's target as well, is more in the center of that range. Folks who could be a little left, could be a little right. They do vote. They just don't vote every single time, but they're registered. They know the importance of it. And it's really just a matter of how can we, and that's any given we, it could be me, it could be another radio show, it could be a candidate. How do we get you to vote a little more often and understand the importance of whatever the next election is, and then persuade you to go either to the left this time or to the right this time, knowing you're open to voting some other way the next time around. That to us is the real target. These are folks who can step up their civic engagement, like you're going to hear in our Women Win Wisconsin segment in just a moment here. And the whole reason I mention this is that I want to talk about the bottom of this, the people on the bottom left and the bottom right. These are people who are there MAGA or they are hardcore lefties, but they never, ever vote. Those are people that are just sitting on their couch yelling at the TV. And then in the middle at the bottom, people who never vote, and they don't know where they are, left or right. I call that group don't know, don't care, don't bother. More from Women Win Wisconsin, powered by Motherhood for Good, next on Up North News Radio. I'm Pat Kreitlum. Just when I'm in a serious mood. Welcome back. On this Thursday morning, time for our Women Win Wisconsin segment. It is powered by Motherhood for Good. Danielle Scampini and Kate Duffy join us again with a special guest and learning all about the issues that are so important, not just for Election Day, but Kate, for Mother's Day. And happy Mother's Day in advance to all of you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, thanks for having us, and happy Mother's Day to Representative Robyn Vining, who's joining us today and has been very fierce in her advocacy for policies that help support mothers and families. We are in for a treat today because, you know, as you know, we've been talking to people who are running for office and just different women in Wisconsin who are doing big things. And Representative Vining has been in the state legislature for a while now. I know we were talking a little bit the other day, Robyn, and your district is changing again because of the maps. And I know this isn't your first time that things are shifting around on you a little bit, and you've become quite flexible. And things have been a little bit interesting since you were first elected into office. So can you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about that path to like when you first got elected and how things have shifted for you since then?
Sure. Thanks, Kate. Thanks, Danielle and Pat. I am so happy to be here. So thank you for having me. So in 2018, I ran for office for the first time. We were running for a red seat. It was a seat that the Republicans had gerrymandered. They called it their pipeline to the governorship. So it was a very deeply red gerrymandered seat. And we looked at the math and thought there might be a crack in the gerrymander that we could try and win. And so I often say it's not candidates that beat gerrymandering, it's communities that do. And so really it wasn't me running, it was we running. It was a big community running. And we really wanted our voice back in the legislature. We wanted to be heard in the legislature. We were thinking about public school funding, gun violence, worrying about our kids and justice issues. And so it was a big deal. So we ran out of 34,000 votes. I won by 138.
Oh my gosh. Like 138, no zeros, no commas.
Unreal.
Okay.
Yeah. Correct. And then, and that was really new for all of us. None of us had done this before. And we just really had our mindset that this is something that we wanted to accomplish. And on the note on Mother's Day, something that I talked about when I was running for office was losing access to maternity health care. Affordable, accessible health care is a human right that we all deserve. And I lost my pregnancy coverage when I was pregnant with my first child. So that was something that we talked a lot about during that race. I think that a lot of women, we came together on that issue, on gun violence, public school funding, and justice issues. So yeah, 138 out of 34,000. We quickly became the top target in the state to take out for the Republicans. I was their top number one target to make sure I did not win again. And I mean, women in Brookfield and Wauwatosa and Milwaukee were working together to defend that seat. And so after winning by 138 votes, 2 years later, we won by over 3,000. So that organizing that we did, that really everybody did, was extraordinary. And this now is my third district in four election cycles, because everything keeps changing. And so my district changed. Instead of Wauwatosa, Brookfield, Milwaukee, it became Wauwatosa, West Allis. And now it has become, in its third iteration, Wauwatosa, Brookfield, and Elm Grove. So Danielle. and I have to say, in those years, we have... what has happened in the organizing amongst people in the suburbs is extraordinary. The energy is exciting, but also like the structures are smart. So it's exciting. It's also smart. And everybody is so hardworking and ready to go. And I mean, that's what makes me believe that we flipped a seat in 2018 and we can do it again this year. So I am drawn in with the Republican incumbent. I am no longer in the 14th Assembly District this election cycle. I'm in the 13th. And now it's time for us to flip another seat.
Yes, definitely. Lucky number 13. So when I first back to Wisconsin and lived in Wauwatosa, you were my rep at the time. So I was proud to vote for you back in 2018, 2020. We moved here. And because I am in Elm Grove, as you mentioned, so you did not represent me until hopefully soon again. So very excited to have you back on the ballot for me. Why do you think you have been successful in gaining and building the widespread community support, you know, as your district has been shifting? Because, you know, anyone who is familiar with this area, like there's a lot that's similar about Tosa and Brookfield and Elm Grove and West Allis and Milwaukee. And there's also a lot that's, you know, unique. And how do you think your support and appeal has, like, how have you been able to maintain that with all of these changes?
Well, I don't think it's me. I think it's we. It's the same as the beginning. I think it is everybody cares about shared values, right? It's the things we care about. We have shared values in from Wauwatosa, Milwaukee, Brookfield, Elm Grove, West Allis. There's shared values across all of those cities. And so we can come together on those things that we care about. But what's happened, even in my absence from Brookfield and that area over the last 2 years, is you guys. I mean, you're building organizational structures and they just keep growing. And I mean, it sure seems like the growth has come from A, really smart women working really hard, and also shared values, the things people care about. They are, we feel like we're fighting for so much right now, and people are really fighting for it. I think I get a lot of calls from the press over, like, internationally for the last 6 years, and they're always asking me, what are women thinking? What are women in the suburbs thinking? And I say, that's not the question. The question is, what are women in the suburbs doing? And I think the whole point is, like, we're not just thinking about things, we're doing them. And what I've seen is extraordinary growth of women figuring out these are important fights worth fighting, and they don't just feel it or believe it, they're actually doing it. So I feel like I'm stepping into an organizing structure that has been built in my absence in Brookfield and Elm Grove. And it's extraordinary. And I am so excited.
Well, you may be stepping into it, but I also think part of your appeal is you're so relatable and you're compassionate, and you are one of those door warriors on the ground talking to people day in and day out, and people love that about you. I feel like you must have no problem like with name recognition, because I feel like Robyn Vining is out there talking to everybody. If she's in your area, you're going to meet her if you have not yet. Let's talk a little bit. Let's shift a little bit. Looking forward to, we know Mother's Day is this Sunday. And like I mentioned in the intro, we've connected with you as an organization because we have so many different policies that are important to us that are important to you as well. Can you talk a little bit about what you've been thinking and doing on those types of things that relate to mothers and families as your work either out on the campaign or currently in the legislature?
Sure. So, well, childcare, I'm thinking about childcare first because I was just at a childcare event last night in Milwaukee with DCF and trying to figure out how do we do things better, right? We got to look at that from every angle. And we've spent the last, how long has it been that we've been fighting for childcare counts, reading letters from constituents, hearing, you know, if my childcare goes up $50 a week, which is, you know, what we are concerned about if childcare counts was not continued. Mm-hmm. I'm choosing between being able to afford to work or being able to afford food. And I mean, that's very real. That was a mom in West Allis who sent me that handwritten letter. And, you know, we're hearing over and over again, just lack of access to affordable quality childcare. Right. And working with Republicans who just refuse to actually tackle the issue. They want to work around it, but they don't want to actually do it. And meanwhile, we've got people who are trying to get back into the workforce, but they can't because they do not have access to quality childcare. And so that's one thing. And then I think on maternal health, I mean, we're one of only three states that has an extended postpartum Medicaid expansion. So to make sure that women have health care through the whole first year after they've had a baby. And that's a battle worth fighting right now, especially because we actually have the votes in the legislature. Mm-hmm. First of all, that has passed the Senate 32-1. And we have, I believe, 66 off the top of my head. I believe it's 66 co-sponsors in the state assembly on that bill. So we have the votes, but the speaker just has a personal issue and he won't call a vote on that bill, blocking women from having health care in the year after they've had a baby. I just think that's just morally repugnant. Women deserve access to health care. That should be an absolute basic here in the most powerful, wealthiest country in the world.
It does make me wonder, Representative Vining, if when we look at, you know, the landscape between now and November, so many people want to focus on, you know, a lot of the traditional issues. Republicans will keep saying, you know, cut taxes, lower spending, everything else. But it seems to me that there are two rather, you know, what you would call kitchen table issues that are going to be bigger motivators of voters, especially women, especially families, than maybe Republicans might think. And the one you just mentioned, and that is not extending postpartum care, one of only three states to say to new moms, you know, too bad. And then the other, and again, I may be wrong, but I think that Republicans continuing to sit for more than 300 days on the money that could be used to clean PFAS out of contaminated drinking water around Wisconsin is just something that I think is going to resonate with a lot of families going, why are Republicans sitting on money instead of cleaning up contaminated water? Am I reading too deeply? Am I spending too much time around these issues? Or do you think that these are two things that could really resonate with families, you know, at doors and in campaign messaging?
I think it's fair to assume that mothers want their children to have access to clean drinking water, whether it's PFAS or lead pipes. Mothers would like their children to have access to clean drinking water. And I think it's, again, a very basic human right. So, yep, absolutely. And then I think talking about the fall of Roe and women's access to health care and our healthcare freedoms. I think that's a big issue. We know that extends across the aisle, and it's a big issue that we're going to see this year. And I know my opponent, the Republican incumbent in the district that we're trying to flip, is an author of the latest abortion ban, an author. And that was a ban that they wrote without exceptions for rape and incest. Those of us on the health committee pushed them and pushed them and pushed them and pushed them and pushed them until they finally added those exceptions. But absolutely, I mean, there's a lot that moms care about, right? And I think it's important for people to realize we don't just think about things, we actually do them. So they should get ready to see us doing the work for the next 6 months before we actually head to the polls.
Yes, definitely. And speaking of doing the work, what would you say are the best ways that people can get involved, can help out? What should we do to help flip the seat, reelect you to the assembly?
Sure. Well, I think the number one thing is, as you mentioned, Kate, name recognition is absolutely critical. It's the number one thing that determines electability, right? And then attaching something to that. Oh, yeah, I know her. She's great. Or she's super fun. Oh, yeah, I know she works really hard, but she's also super fun. and I think it's you can go to Robyn for Wisconsin, Robynforwi.com. Come and we have a volunteer form, and we have volunteer opportunities for all kinds of things for introverts. I'm an introvert, so I'm sensitive to it. Introverts, extroverts, you have a baby, you need to push a stroller, but you have 1 hour to do doors, not three. You don't want to do doors. You want to write postcards quietly alone in your house. We've got all kinds of stuff. And so lots of ways to volunteer. And we really try to build community along the way. One of the great opportunities of campaign season is building community in the community where you're seeking office. I think that shows whether or not you really care about the people that you're seeking to serve. So, yep, you can go to the website, sign up our volunteer form. We'd love to hear from you. And we got to raise a lot of money. Be happy to have you donate.
By the way, if you need to know more about writing postcards quietly, go back quite a ways on the Motherhood for Good Instagram, and Kate has a video on what you call naptivism. Is writing naptivism. Writing those postcards while the little ones rest. State Representative Robyn Vining, thank you so much. It was great to see you.
Thanks so much for having me.
You bet. Kate, Danielle, thanks so much again. Have a wonderful start to the weekend.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kat.
Top Chef in just a moment. First, a reminder that Brewers tickets are still up for grabs. If you head over to the Civic Media app and text one of the stations where you hear Up North News Radio, we ask, what's the website to go to sign up for the Up North News daily newsletter? Had several people that were close, but not quite there. So send us that website, that .com address, text it to us. And you're the first one to do that. We've got 4 tickets to Saturday's game, Brewers versus the Cardinals, at American Family Field. Luke Mathers is here now, as always on Thursdays, and at least for these past 8 weeks or so, to talk about Top Chef, and apparently something that was a really big deal last night, but again, not being a Top Chef aficionado such as yourself, they all got excited. Did you get excited too when you heard them say, this week, Restaurant Wars?
Yeah, it was it's always, you know, it's always coming each season, but you never know quite when, because typically speaking, they've tried to throw some curveballs in on when it's scheduled. For the longest time, it was pretty much the top 8. Once you got down 4v4, you knew that you were going to Restaurant Wars, because that was the estimated amount of people that were needed for a team to be able to run the front of house, create the concept together, expedite, and cook the way that the restaurant progressive menu should work. So it became evident most seasons that it was around when there were 8 contestants left. Now, we had 2 people come back from Last Chance Kitchen in the first half of that kind of parallel show this season. So we didn't really know if that was going to throw off the schedule or what, but they seemed determined to do it this week. So even though they had 9 contestants, they said we're going forward with Restaurant Wars.
All right. So they were at Discovery World. Tell the folks what is Restaurant Wars? What do they have to do like within like 24 hours or so here?
This is one of the highest stress episodes each season because the team is tasked with coming up with a restaurant, cohesive restaurant concept, a menu that makes sense in that concept, the creation of all of the front of the house aesthetics, so going and picking out the plates and the silverware and the cups and the napkins, all of the front of the house aspects as well, along with training a wait staff to figure out how to expedite when to take the orders, bring the orders to the kitchen, and then successfully execute a night's dinner service under that restaurant concept. And if you've ever talked to any restaurateur, they would laugh at you, Pat, if you tried to do something like that in 24 hours.
I mean, go back to when you were like, say, 7 or 8 years old, and maybe you would play restaurant for your mom and dad. And it's like you'd act all fancy. You'd put some napkins out or whatever. That's a great kid's game. These folks are said with now not just go to the grocery store and get all the groceries and cook something up, but you're going to these rental stores to get the things that you'll need.
You have to train the waiters, wait staff that's coming in. There's a lot to be done in that period of time.
So they gussied up these two different rooms at Discovery World, basically side by side. And they got them all decorated. They planned out a menu. They cooked. So to get, and again, people figured out here, we're not getting really deep into the details of the actual food because I can't write that fast. And I'm more about what's actually going on and not what the food is. But it seems that the vibe I got was a mistake that's always made is, okay, our concept for a restaurant is it's like Oprah. It's about me. It's about what do I know? And so you got like 4 different people and each one takes their experience or their favorite food and mashes it all together. And the judges are always like, that's not a concept, you know? And am I right? Is that kind of one of the things that trips up the restaurant wars every season?
That is a huge aspect. The balance also between the front of house and the kitchen is usually a very high pressure point for stress. As you may have noticed on last night's episode, Danny, who was expediting for the Channel team, that was the name of their restaurant concept, he created tickets overnight to smooth out the expedition process when it came to taking in orders from the front of house, which was something that the other team dramatically needed as well. And
I thought when he did that, I thought he was going to get dinged for like, oh, you shouldn't have wasted your time with that. No, it turned out that's the thing, because the other restaurant next door, they were messing up tickets and orders left and right, and people were left waiting forever for food. And it's just a reminder that, yeah, you can be the world's greatest chef. You can have the world's best food. But if it comes out cold, it doesn't do you any good. The whole house matters when it comes to a restaurant.
Yeah, and Restaurant Wars really gives the judges an insight on how all of these different chefs really conduct themselves in not just the creation of an excellent dish, but what it takes to be a chef when it comes to front to end, like beginning to end restaurant concept. And a lot of times you'll see people go home in Restaurant Wars for not taking the lead, because that's what a chef ultimately needs to do.
Well,
and so when you have a problem that everything kind of just falls to the wayside and nobody claims it, that's when you can send your knives. You get sent home with your knives packing.
Or you try to take the lead and do a terrible job at it, and you're just bossing people around, which is how Kalina got kicked out the first time, and it's how she got kicked out again last night. And I was not surprised, and I was not unhappy, because everything is always somebody else's fault with her. And she got eliminated a couple of weeks back. She went through the Last Chance Kitchen thing and got to come back, but now she's off again. It's like she hadn't learned anything yet about how to communicate in a kitchen. cook as well as you want, but you got to communicate.
Yeah, that expedition position when you are responsible for all of the dishes that go out and there are some subpar dishes, it's an easy way to fast track yourself out of the competition.
And let's talk about our man Dan from Milwaukee. His appetizer dish for the restaurant was based on walleye, and he was very much rewarded for that.
Yeah, and it was a team effort, though. He was planning to do something originally with beets, and the rest of the team kind of told him, hey, we don't know if that necessarily falls right in the concept. Good. What if we did something with seafood? He was going to do a smoked trout, and then the grocery store didn't have it. So he's like, all right, I'll do walleye, and he made the best of it with the winning dish.
So he did walleye, and I thought, oh, that's going to break the budget. That's where I thought things were going to go wrong, but it didn't, and Dan ended up being the winner last night, and moving on. And then next week, the preview involves what appears to be members of the indigenous community. Cranberries and other food will be spotlighted there. So
yeah, it looks like a good one, Pat. I'm excited for it.
It does. And so great job, Luke, of recapping. And we didn't get any grief at all from Greg. So let's just say his favorite word together.
I love Discovery World.
Thank you, Mr. Mathers. Have a great day.
You too, Pat.
Greg will be with the Great Jane Matinee coming up at 10 o'clock, where they have a guest talking about socks, because they are an epic show that way, and I'm so jealous. Up North News is the Wisconsin outlet for Courier, a pro-democracy news network, building a more informed, engaged, and representative America. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We'll see you Friday morning, 6 a.m.